5 days out, and we're taking 5 minutes to hear from the leaders, starting with the Liberals' Justin Trudeau. Here's National Affairs correspondent Omar Sachedina.
Mr. Trudeau, it's good to see you.
Good to see you, Omar.
You have now had 32 days and three debates to convince Canadians why it's necessary for them to spend $600 million on an election during a pandemic, during an unfolding humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan. The fact that you still have to defend your decision to call this election, what does that tell you?
Well, I think Canadians are seeing that there are very different ideas about how to end this pandemic, how to move forward on climate change, on childcare, on housing. And Canadians deserve a choice because those decisions are going to be taken by the government now, in the coming weeks, not a year from now, not 2 years from now. And that's the choice Canadians get to make.
But your budget had passed.
Mm-hmm.
You had struck deals with 8 provinces and territories on a signature initiative that this country has been waiting on for decades, which is child care. There are many Canadians out there who would say that by calling this election, You have put that in jeopardy. You've put those deals in jeopardy.
The only thing putting childcare in jeopardy is Erin O'Toole's desire to turn it back, to rip up deals that give Canadians
$10
a
day. But you decided when to call this election, Mr. Trudeau.
I know Canadians want childcare not just for their families, but for jobs, for economic growth, for businesses who've said, you're right, this pandemic has taught us affordable childcare is an economic policy. Mr. O'Toole's making the wrong choice, and Canadians have the opportunity to show that.
Canadians, of course, want a leader they can trust, a leader with integrity. And to be frank, you've broken several of your pledges. Even before the surge in pandemic spending, you abandoned your pledge to balance the books. Ending boil water advisories by March 2021 didn't happen. Electoral reform didn't happen. Affordable housing, still unaffordable in major cities across the country. And your plan to tackle hate, incidents of hate increased in this country under your watch, rather than decreased. Why should Canadians give you yet another mandate? Why should they trust you?
Well, I think Canadians have seen that over the past 6 years, not only did we create 1 million jobs, but we lifted 1 million people out of poverty. We've moved forward on ending 116 boil water advisories and have a plan to end all of them.
But your pledge was March 2021. There are still people in a G7 country that can't have access to safe water.
Yes, and we will lift them all. The pandemic slowed some things down.
And when? What's the new timeline?
In the coming months and year. We promised big things, and we've delivered big things, but yes, there is more to do. And that's why the choice of whether we go stronger on fighting against racism and intolerance when a conservative platform didn't even mention the word racism, the choice becomes clear.
I want to move on to Quebec's ban on religious symbols. You've said it doesn't foster hate, and yet you're leaving the door open to a legal challenge to intervening. Why would you consider fighting a law you don't think is discriminatory?
I have been very clear from the beginning that I disagree with that law.
Canadians
and Quebecers know that well. What I've also said is that I will not take off the table, unlike the other leaders, including Jagmeet Singh.
But Mr. Trudeau, what specifically do you disagree about Bill 21?
I don't think a government should be telling a woman what she should or should not wear. That's not something that we want to see
in a free
society.
But that's exactly what Quebec is doing. Why won't you use the term discrimination?
That's why I disagree with it. And that's why we have not taken off the table challenging at one point. I've been saying that for years because a federal government always needs to stand up for people's fundamental rights, and Quebecers know that.
And you could stand up for it today by calling the law discriminatory. Why are you not using that word?
I have said that I disagree with the law and are watching carefully as Quebecers defend their rights in court.
In 2015, you delivered a gender-balanced cabinet. Now it's 2021. Will you commit to having 50% representation from Black, Indigenous, people of color, not only in your cabinet, but in your ministerial staff, including your chiefs of staff, and also in the Prime Minister's office? Because right now, the numbers are only 29 out of 98 people in the Prime Minister's office identify as BIPOC. So would you commit to that 50% target?
I commit to continuing to doing more. What we have done over the past years is bring in far more diversity into the Prime Minister's office than ever before, into Cabinet. We're going to continue to make sure that we're the party that not just upholds diversity in Canada, but embodies it.
Part of being a good leader is looking back and reflecting on your decisions. What do you consider to be a political mistake or misstep, and what has it taught you?
You know, Omar, your job is very much to point out where we've made mistakes. Of course, you will continue to do that, and I will continue to focus on how we need to be there to serve Canadians moving forward.
So you don't have an answer to that?
I've talked many times about different things that we learned during the pandemic and different things that will move forward. We learned on the scramble on PPE that we had to go even more aggressively, and we did on vaccinations, and now we're leading the world, even as Canadians continue to need to get vaccinated to get through this. I'll be unequivocal on that one. That's one of the things we learned, to trust science as we move forward, and we're doing that.
Mr. Trudeau, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Omar.